Today, I will first talk about the book project I am working with Professor Aida Wien Wong at Brandeis University, and then focus more on my own research on menswear in modern Korea, followed by examples of cultural cross-dressing. This book, entitled Fashion, Identity, and Power in Modern Asia, assembles innovative research on the themes of dress reform around the 1850s to 1940s in East Asia. Essays in the book explore Chinese, Japanese, and Korean adoption of modern dress, the new understanding of the body, and the gender identity in the larger context of trade, power, modernization, and socio-political discourses. Contributing authors from Hong Kong, Taiwan, China, UK, Japan, and North America illuminate with an unprecedented scope and from a transcultural perspective the intersections between art history, fashion history, history of consumption, political and economic history, and cultural studies. So these are the table of contents, preview, what will be included. In the process of modernization, East Asian clothing underwent conspicuous changes. The Meiji government in Japan ordered a westernized version of attire for military and government officials. Cultural leaders also responded with their own interpretations of modern identity through hybrid fashion. In late Qing and early Republican China, changing dress styles that incorporated imported tailoring and fabrics reflected the transition from the millennia-old dynastic system to modern nationhood. King Gojong of late Joseon Korea, as you can see here, this is not actually King Gojong, Gojong's son, King Sunjong later on. So King Gojong of late Joseon Korea, under Japanese influence, deemed the adoption of new attires essential to modernization and decreed a series of dress reforms from the 1880s on. But the forced removal of traditional marks of status and manhood, such as broad sleeves and a top knot, met with vehement opposition from ministers to the ordinary people. Some people threatened to kill themselves instead of cutting their hair. In the late 20th century, the mass media started to play a strong role in disseminating new designs that closely followed socio-political trends. The modernization of dress in East Asia also coincided with the diaspora of Asian immigrants to Europe and Americas in the late 19th and early 20th century. At the end of the lecture, I will present some examples of cultural cross-dressing by Asians and non-Asians during the Gilded Age in the US. So just briefly, in traditional Korean attire is something like a dress that worn by the queen of Sunjong. But this is official photograph of the royal family from the early 20th century. This is right before Korea was annexed to Japan. So what is remarkable in this photograph? Or something is not remarkable to you? What is unusual about this photograph?
Dress.
The king, this is imperial dress with the European convention, and then the queen, on the other hand, she also had something European on her. That is this ribbons, right? This is like sort of a word or a symbol of their status, but her own dress is a traditional Korean dress. But if you see the painting on the right side, this is a Japanese imperial family taken around 1900. And here, what is remarkable? Or what grabs your attention? Right, the adult family members in the imperial family, they are all dressed up like a British royal family, with dresses and European military uniforms. But in this photograph, children wear traditional clothes. So I am not analyzing this photograph in this talk, but you can think about this undertone about the divisions of dress, like who is going to wear symbols of modernization versus who can still wear traditional clothes and not violating any social conventions or diplomatic protocols. The reason King Gojong, his father, adopted this European attire is in order to match the European diplomats when there is banquets or diplomatic ceremonies. But women who stay in the sort of private sector, who doesn't go, you know, go out for these banquets, it's okay to have a traditional dress, or maybe it's a way of preserving their own identity in women's attire. Like who decides what to wear? It's usually by the royal edict. You know, this is something interesting phenomenon that you will bear in your mind until the end of the talk. I am not talking about this, but I want you to see this drastic change. So Emperor Meiji in a traditional attire as an emperor versus right after the Meiji Restoration, he wears again the European attires. But there is something interesting about this photograph. Again, I am not discussing the analysis of the images, I mean the attire here, but emperor usually is not supposed to be shown to the public, especially in this photographic media. He's somebody who's really mysterious, sort of secretive, you know, have this confidential aura. But here, he has to exude the image of modern ruler to the European audience as well as Japanese audience. So here, because he was a reluctant photograph taker, his face is sort of patched to this photograph. So the body is not his body, but the face is his face. So it's a composite image. Anyhow, this is a drastic change that we often talk about, the Meiji Restoration followed by the opening of Japan in the middle of the 1850s. And another change that you have to bear in mind is introduction of European buildings. Why do you need this type of attire? You cannot sit on the floor with this dress, right? This is for a chair or like a table settings, as you can see here. So introduction of new buildings. Again, men working in the public area, they would go to this kind of palaces or government buildings, and they have to wear European attire. But women staying in the household, again, they can wear traditional clothes and have you know, sedentary lifestyle, like sitting on the floor and working in a traditional kitchen. So these are examples of Japanese European buildings. This one, Rokumeikan, and then in Tokyo, the palace. So in the, for these type of buildings, sort of enforce the people to adopt new mode of dress as well. So this is actually a surviving example from King Gojong's reign, showing the new dress. So traditionally, the Joseon dynasty officials would wear like a long robe with rank badges embroidered you know, on the, you know, chest. But after the Kabul Reformation in 1895, again, King Gojong ordered all of his government officials to adopt this new mode of dress, embroidered. Embroideries here, I want you to pay a close attention. What do you think this motif is? Usually what do you see on European tailored dress? Sort of stitches, right? Like an arrow-shaped or sort of a coat of arms type of, you know, decorations. But if you see carefully, do you recognize that these are flowers?
Yeah,
it's flowers, right? But what kind of flowers? Not peony. Peony is a common subject matter for traditional Chinese flower and insect painting. And in this case, this is Rose of Sharon. Do you know the Rose of Sharon, like a national flower of South, I mean, Korea? So they invented new symbols. This is also time that you need a national flag, you need a national symbol, like a lot of national, you know, insignia. So they were developing this new motif, so they embroidered the Rose of Sharon as a motif. And that represents a government official of the Korean Empire. Actually, this is called the Korean Empire. And I actually know a costume historian who works on this period, and you know, a lot of my research today, my lecture today actually based on her research as well. She actually knows how to embroider these rows of Sharon motifs with gold thread. If you think about introduction of new clothes, then you may wonder, then who's going to make this kind of clothes, right? In Joseon Dynasty, there was a royal chamber of seamstresses. It's called the sangbang. And in this, the government department, there are a lot of women hired to embroider or sew. But would they know how to make this kind of European dress? Obviously not, right? So in the beginning, they ordered this kind of dress to dressmaker in tailor in Paris, sometimes Russia, and then eventually some of them learned how to do these techniques. So there are a lot of new introduction of techniques and materials. So that's what I'm going to talk today. So before moving into my actual talk, in these photographs, what grabs your attention? Let's look at the man. What is a bit odd about him? Well, it looks totally natural to you. Is this man a European gentleman? No, obviously, somewhere from Asia. So this is a Japanese photograph, and in the beginning, after the Meiji Restoration, it became a popular trend to go to a photographer's studio and pose. I don't know whether you remember the days when you went to photographer's studio to have a photo taken. This man, example, I mean, he's not a government official or not working for the bank. He doesn't have any reason to dress up as European gentleman's suit, like a top hat, this type of coat, a flat coat. He didn't, have to wear this. So where did he go? A photographer's studio, sort of try on something new. So that's why he is trying to take off the gloves. But if you see his shoes, some are really worn out, right? Not really polished in your new shoes. So people were doing a lot of these. So it's a social change, abrupt change. What about this? Telephone. What is remarkable about it? Yes, this is when the telephone is introduced. And the print is a little bit ambiguous whether she is actually working in the public office or not working or staying home, and she happens to have a telephone in her house. It's not so certain, but again, the point I wanted to make is women still can wear traditional clothes and work either in public or in private. I didn't bring any photos today, but postal workers in Japan, especially in the early 20th century, there used to be a lot of women postal workers, but what did they wear to work in the postal buildings? Still traditional clothes. So there is a very interesting phenomenon that imperial members in Japan, like women, queens and princesses, they wear European dress to take a photo taken, but probably in their own private quarters, they still wore traditional clothes. And this is another image that I want you to bear in mind, that the sort of a hybrid urban life or city view. Which element gives you an idea that this is a city at the turn of the 20th century?
Electricity train?
Yeah, how do you know? This is a tram, right? Tram, the above the ground, you have the tram. And then do you see these electric poles? So this is Seoul in 1905. So this is, again, right before Korea is annexed by Japan. So you have this sort of hybrid urban street view. Like you have South Gate type of big gate, city gate, and then traditional buildings. But then you have like a two-story sort of a modern building, maybe for shops, and then you have tram and then electric poles. So again, majority of the citizens would wear some sort of traditional clothes, but then, you know, urban elite working in the government offices or working in the diplomacy, or colonial government, they would wear a modern suit. So today, I am going to talk a little bit about the development of menswear. So I'm going to start my paper. A dandy or a beau is a man who places scrupulous importance upon physical appearance, refined language, and leisurely habits in a cult of self. Do you think you are a dandy? You can raise your hand. You are a dandy? During and after the Industrial Revolution in Britain, a dandy was typically a self-made man from a middle-class background, imitating an aristocratic lifestyle. They are not aristocrat himself, but he's imitating the lifestyle of aristocrat, and they are called dandy. It is known that the modern practice of dandyism first appeared in the revolutionary 1790s in London and in Paris. A similar concept to a dandy is a flaneur, meaning stroller or lounger in French. The flaneur was a literary type of a man from Paris in the 19th century. Walter Benjamin defined the importance of this type as an emblematic archetype of urban modern experience. Following Benjamin, the flaneur has become an important symbol for scholars, artists, and writers. The term usually connects with bourgeois status, the man of leisure, an idler, the urban explorer, the connoisseur of the street, and the hobbyist. As we see in the photograph of artistic intellectuals of colonial Korea taken in the 1930s, European woolen fabric was accessible to the city elite and consumed by modernized intellectuals like Yi Sang, Park Tae-won, and Gu Bo-nung. Before I move on with my lecture, I want to talk a bit about these people. The reason I chose a photograph of men in a tailored suit among artists and intellectuals are they are sort of leisurely class. They don't work in the government office. Some of them worked, but usually they don't have official position, but they like to wear well-tailored clothes. And I want you to think about this change is when you make tailored suit, what is the most common material? Can you make a men's suit like this with silk? Sometimes you can do, but then you would look like what, the hustler or the ballroom, the dandy. You don't want to have those. So the proper material is actually woolen fabric. It's well knit woolen fabric, and that's totally new to Asian people. There were, as I'm going to explain, there were some felt, like animal, fur material felt, but there is no like a woven woolen fabric. Where do you get woven woolen fabric in the early 20th century then?
England.
Yeah, it's heavily imported by England. And then actually the US was another important importer of woven woolen fabric. And then you may go to Australia. The raw wool, like eventually Japan is going to create their own facilities. So 1920s and 30s, Japanese companies are going to make their own version of woven fabric. But where do you get the sheep? Where do you get the raw wool? In Japan? Again, you import from either Britain or Australia. So I'm going to talk a little bit more about those introduction of new fabrics. But I want you to think about how novel it is to have woolen fabric. How do you wash woolen fabric? Can you wash in the water? Right, you either wash in the cold water or, as we know, you have to use like a dry cleaners, right? Like the oil-based solvent. So in this period, in the city, there are going to actually stores dedicated to clean the hat, not to clean the suit. Suit probably not many cleaners in the city, but if you see a photograph from the early 20th century from city of Tokyo or, for example, city of Seoul, then you will see the hat cleaning shops. Have you ever seen hat cleaning shops? I don't know how young you are, but you know, if you have a top hat, you know, that matches this kind of dress, the top hat is made of felt, like the woolen felt. And where are you going to clean those, right? You, certainly you cannot wash it. So there was a specialized hat cleaning shops in certain cities. So I want you to bear in, you know, want you to think about the urban fabric where predominantly people are going to wear traditional robe. They may wear leather shoes, but you know, a lot of people are going to wear sort of a white, you know, light color robe. But then in between, you may see this kind of well-dressed people, very noticeable. Here, Yisang, as you can see here, this man is a famous writer. And then Park Tae-won is the man with glasses, like this hair. Park Tae-won. And then Gu Bo-nung is an artist. You can see here. So these are the group of people who wear European suit in a fashionable manner. Moving on. So at the same time, modern city was transforming human beings, giving them a new relationship to time and space. At the same time, some people chose to mix and match their modern accessories with traditional wardrobe. As one can see in the novelist Yi Guangsu's photograph from 1937, a man born in the late 1890s did not give up his durumagi, like a long traditional overcoat, even while he adopted a short haircut and a top hat. The top hat was usually made of wool and purchased at a department store. I would call this mode of mix and match of modernized clothing or accessory items with traditional attire a hybrid dandyism. In East Asia, during the early 20th century, this mode of hybrid fashion was ubiquitous also in China or in Japan. A street view of Shanghai in this 1910 photograph shows various degrees of hybrid dandyism, a mixture of woolen top hat with Manchu-style overcoat, a man in European suit and coat with a proper hat, and rickshaw drivers in their humble attire with different types of European hats. A Japanese man among fashionable train passengers, as is depicted in a magazine illustration of the Meiji period, he exudes his modernity in a modernized woolen overcoat worn over his traditional kimono. With wide sleeves, the coat was meant to accommodate the long, broad sleeves of a kimono. Yet, it used the woolen fabric for warmth and had tailored colors in imitation of a European frock coat. So sometimes, instead of matching existing items, you sometimes design the whole new garment in this hybrid manner. So the man I was describing is here. He actually wears the Japanese shoes, right, slippers, and then underneath Japanese kimonos, but he needs something warm. This is actually the existing coat. So it's a kimono style, like a flat, you know, tailoring with long sleeve. But then you also have the European style, like colors. But then you can wear it over your kimono because the sleeves are tailored in this manner. So there are new designs. In fact, making an overcoat in a woolen textile was a popular trend in East Asian countries during the early 20th century. As you can see here, what can you notice in this case? What is a hybrid about this gentleman? The hat is actually not a top hat, do you notice? What kind of hat is this? The traditional Korean gat, it's called gat. It's actually made of horse hair. It's woven horse hair. It's a transparent like a head. And then he ties them together because it's a little smaller than your, you know, circumference of the head. But then, what about his pants? The traditional hanbok, right? And then shoes. This is like, again, traditional shoes. But then he wanted to have the overcoat because it's a trendy thing. But not only trendy thing, but wool has a certain strength as a fabric. It's light, but so warm. Can you imagine? silk, of course, it gives you a lot of warmth, but if you have layers of silk or like a, you know, really thick silk, it's rather heavy. So when they discovered the advantage of wool fabric, it was irresistible. So this sort of a country, you know, the grandfather wanted to adopt a coat. So here what you see is, it's called oba, meaning like an overcoat, made for Joseon people. So Japanese dry goods store and say, well, you can buy these. But you can imagine it's a little bit of a novelty and expensive, right? If it's expensive, what are you going to do? You can buy a used clothes. So eventually you will see the store selling the used coat. Because overcoat, as you can imagine, it's very sturdy, right? So you can reuse it. Animal furs or woolen felt had been utilized in East Asian countries since ancient times. These were often incorporated into armor and other utilitarian clothes for cold weather. Nonetheless, woolen fabric made of sheep wool was rare until the end of the 18th century. In Japan, it is said that European woolen textiles were introduced by Portuguese merchants in the 16th century. Even after trade with foreign merchants was banned during the Tokugawa period, wealthy samurais or daimyos, the generals, still used woolen textiles to make jinbaori, a military overcoat worn over armor to protect the wearer from rain and cold weather. So what you are looking at here is, you probably have seen Japanese armor in the museums, right? Metropolitan Museum has a lot of them. You have all of these. But then, in the winter time, it's still cold. That armor is made of brasses, lacquer, and a little bit of wood, you know, all together. It's heavy and, you know, cold. So on top of it, you need a large overcoat. So this is really wide. So you can, like your blanket, it go over your shoulders and armor. But since the 16th century, you know, Portuguese merchants brought British woolen fabric. So they were buying little bits of it, and they knew that, oh, it's so warm and light. This is an example of that jinbaori, like the type of large overcoat over the armor, made for daimyo of Kaga domain. And then you have to put some decorations. So here it has a Portuguese ships on the decoration. So there are some pieces remaining in the museums. So there are many surviving woolen jinbaoris from the 19th century, while Osaka Castle has a woolen jacket associated with Oda Nobunaga, and it's dated to the 16th century. A mass import of European woolen textiles, however, should be credited to rigorous salesmanship of the British East Asian Company. Remember the British East Asian Company who were selling a lot, who were trying to sell a lot of things to Asia? Nothing was so successful. That's why, what did they sell eventually?
Opium,
right? They couldn't sell this, they couldn't sell that. So eventually they have to sell something, so that why don't we cultivate opium in India and sell it to southern China, right? So then what happened? Opium war, right? You know, destruction. But among those items that are sold by British East Asian Company, the only thing that was somehow popular was the woolen textiles. Rachel Silverstein has shown that the demand for British camlet, this fabric is called camlet, since it was gradually introduced to Chinese market in the 18th century, dramatically increased over the turn of the 19th century. Although silk remained popular and luxurious throughout periods in China, Manchu elites, the ruling class of the Qing dynasty, started to realize how light and warm British woolen textile was. As is shown in the early 19th century watercolor painting of Canton shops, Chinese textile merchants included and advertised woolen fabric in their shops. Robust demand came from fashion elites who liked their overcoat, called magua, made from bright woolen camlet. So these are the The example of a watercolor painting of store selling camlet, blue here, what they are sell. These are selling, telling us that they sell woven silk fabrics. But then here, the new items, it actually says a feather thread. It means it's really light. They are selling the blue camlet. So these are sort of textures of camlet. So these are called magua. So as you can see, the Manchu clothes also has a large, you know, sleeve. Again, you have to wear on top of it, so wide sleeve. And then it's some embroidered and decorated, but the color is round, right? So just tight around there, like a Manchu style robe, and then they can wear. But this red one that you see over here, that's the same fabric that you've seen here, camlet. So it's warm and light, and nice color. They like to wear these kind of clothes. A serious demand for woolen textile, however, coincided with the modernization of dresses for official ceremonies of the government. Before I go here, in Japan, they also made the fukusa. It's a cloth for gift wrapping in the late Edo and the Meiji period. And as shown in this example, the outer side was made of wool and the lining was made of silk. So this side is actually the red, is the woolen textiles. On Edo period, ukiyo-e print explains how sheep is raised for its wool. So as the new fabric is introduced, there is like a certain interest in how it's made. It's not silk or it's not cotton. So they show that it comes from the animal. So these are the customs of the Russians. So what do Russians do? They raise sheep and, you know, they take fur from the sheep and create woolen textiles. So there are some interest on this. So during the Meiji Restoration, the Iwakura mission came back to Japan in 1873 in their tailored European suits. So this is right after the Meiji Restoration. The emperor sent the Iwakura mission, like this group of diplomats, envoys, to the US and then to Europe to study what has been accomplished in European countries, what the modern technology is. So they went to Europe and then as you can see in this photograph, when they came back, this is how they came back. What is shocking? Well, what would have been shocking to the Japanese audience? Well, he maintained the same clothes the way he left and then the way he came back. What about others? They somehow brought these new. So this is actually the beginning of tailored suit worn by Asians. Previously, you may see diplomats, European diplomats, you know, in this clothes visiting Japanese or Chinese palaces. But among the Asians, this is what they came back. And for example, if you go to another country, you may start with the traditional clothes, and there, let's say in Boston or in New York, you may take off your clothes and, you know, borrow their own clothes. But then when you come back, you may leave your tailored suit and put on your Japanese clothes and come home, right? But in this case, these young men actually cut their hair. Do you see it? So after this event, the Japanese government is going to create a major dress reform. And that's how you hear about Japanese samurais create these rebellions. And one of the rules is actually you cannot carry your guns, your sword in public places. And, you know, carrying sword was a great privilege for samurai class. And now I say you have to give up your privilege. And that humiliated samurais. So there was actually a big rebellion among the samurais in Kyushu. And this is the beginning of it. So do you see how shiny their top hat is?
Yeah.
Have you ever seen the top hat in real life? It's really, really shiny. And then it's a little like a sort of luster in it. And then usually when you buy this, it comes with a very nice case. You can see those in the museums. So this is a big change for the Japanese audience. So what about Korea? Around the same time, European merchants set up their shops in Incheon. Do you know the city of Incheon in Korean Peninsula? As is known in the famous Sechang Yangheng. These are actually the name of the store. Sechang is a sort of name, and the Yangheng means foreign goods store. So in order to buy match, do you know the match? Like in order to light, so match was a new thing. Or if you want to buy some ointment, you'd go to this Sechang Yangheng. And again, if you want to buy shirts or neckties, then you'd go to Sechang Yangheng. So in the beginning, they were a company. This is actually set up by German merchants, usually catering to foreigners staying in Korea, and then but gradually wealthy people who like to buy new things. Where would you buy your wristwatch? Here, you have to go to Sechang Yangheng in order to buy the wristwatch. Or campus, you know, something really new and novel, fountain pen, you'd go here and buy. But anyhow, so the man, the German entrepreneur, his name was Mr. Meyer and Karl Walter. So this is the store. And as you can see, these are the Meyer and then Walter. But then two men cannot operate their business, right? So they hired a Korean man and then other men. But these are really different degrees of modernization. Both are fine, right? You either both have short hair, but he decided to have a proper three-piece European tailored suit, and he still kept his, you know, traditional shoes and clothes, but short hair. That's okay. So Kim Ok-kyun, the young man that you see over here, he created a three-day Gapsin coup in 1884. So he failed. But Gojong, King Gojong, realized the need for nationwide reform Gojong created the Kabo reform in 1894 and 1896. When Gojong claimed the Korean Empire in 1897, he adopted the modernized tailored suit and ordered government officials to dress themselves in daeryebok, you know, the European frock coat that you saw is called daeryebok, based on the European frock coat in diplomatic and national ceremonies. Due to this dress policy of the government in Japan and in Korea, the demand for woolen textile became permanent and steady. Until the 1920s, Japanese tailors had depended on imported woolen textile. Until 1920s, in cities like Kobe, Nagoya, and eventually Tokyo, modern tailors were rapidly educated and trained. So in the beginning, people like Sechang Yangheng people would bring their own tailors, foreign tailors. They live in Nagoya or Kobe a few years and create frock coat and other necessary items for the audience. But then Japanese men saw the business opportunity, so they rapidly go to tailoring school, tailoring institutions, and learn tailoring. So because uniforms were required for both government employees, such as postal workers, policemen, soldiers, and for school system, students had to wear uniforms, tailors and tailor shops were in high demand. Do you remember when you had the uniforms? You are, again, very young, but I remember that my mother's generation, they always wore uniforms, and they used to go to actually tailor shops to have uniforms made. These days, people buy like a ready-made clothes, you know, depending on your size. Due to high demand of weaved cotton textiles, the uniforms, school uniforms, are made of cotton. Do you know why? Because it should be practical, right? It's not for diplomatic occasion, it should be practical. So they wear tailored uniforms, but these are made of cotton. So Japanese government started cotton textile factories. Yet the production of woolen textiles made little progress by the turn of the 20th century. Most importantly, supplies of raw wool were also dependent on importation. Woolen textile was still considered an imported luxury. Along with European wristwatches, British-style woolen suits were not accessible to ordinary citizens. So this is the King Gojong who adopted again the radical dress reform. And then this is where I'm going to. Nonetheless, the Japanese manufacturers finally produced a steady amount of woolen textile and created the Japanese Wool Industry Association in 1920. It is therefore after 1920 that Korean men adopted a dandy lifestyle in cities like Seoul, Busan, Incheon, and Daegu. So this one shows the drastic increase. Like 1910 to 14. This is actually when First World War started, right? When the First World War started, where can Japan import their woolen textile? They cannot, right? British, you know, Empire was very busy with war in the continent. So Japanese manufacturers really, you know, push themselves to have the skills. So here, around 1919, like skyrocketed, like the way they can produce. And then during this time, again, they cannot bring raw wool from England, so they went to Australia. How convenient that Australia is in Pacific Ocean, right? You went down, and then brought up. Students and police officers had already adopted uniforms in the Japanese style after the annexation of Korea in 1910. During the early colonial period, men were more visible in public spaces with their modern tailored suits, while women stayed in domestic spaces dressed in hanbok. So this is a typical idea of showing men in European suit, women traditional wedding gown. And I don't know about you, but in Korea, this combination is still very acceptable, and or how can I say, they are very used to this. Like a mother would wear hanbok, but then the husband or the father would wear the tailor suit, but it's considered very well-dressed formal attire. But he, again, is not the government employee. So it's his wedding day, so he borrowed this clothes. Women too, it's not her own clothes. There are rental shops, so she borrowed her clothes. But during the Japanese period, this is a suitable or acceptable combination. Men in suit and the women here. And I'm going to talk a little bit about these novels. Tailors, with a growing supply of woolen textile from Japan, tailors were eager to attract more customers, as is shown with the announcement from Jongno Tailors, which opened in 1916. Here again, in similar way, so women stay at home in a private quarter, again, traditional clothes. Men, on the other hand, in this case, it's a newspaper caricature, so it's very like a bombast, you know, like a pompous, and you know, like a arrogant, and you follow me. But she carries all the luggage and then children, right? So it's a social, like a anecdote. But I want to tell you one thing, like regarding school uniform. There are not many examples of surviving uniforms. But do you see this man over here? Sorry about going to. Do you see the man in the like a long coat with a little black hat? So the hat is actually the symbol of his school. So he's still in school, meaning more like a college. During the Japanese colonial period, college students, men, they also wear uniforms. So this is actually famous novel between very subjective and docile woman heroine, and then the man over there, and then actually in this case, women betrays the student because he's a student, not very wealthy, so she is going to a very wealthy man to get married. So it's a love affair, heartbroken, but it's originally Japanese novel, and then it became Korean version of novel, but in both cases, like a school uniforms, it's a great symbol of certain social status. He has potential, right? Potential to be a good husband and good worker, but in this case, he's the one who was dumped by the the girlfriend. So here, the 정자옥 or Georgia. Georgia is known as the first tailor shop in Korea, established by the Japanese in 1906. Kim Ki-seok has noted that there were only about 30 to 40 shops owned by the Japanese or the Korean in the mid-1910s in Seoul. After the male students' school uniforms changed to a tailored style in the late 1910s, there was a dramatic increase in tailor shops during the 1920s. Many Korean tailors were educated at the Yangbok education centers, meaning tailoring schools, and opened their own shops after the education. For example, Yeonhee College, it's actually Yonsei University now, adopted modernized uniforms in 1918 with a high standard color and five buttons bearing a college emblem at the front, following a brief period in 1914 to 15. As more schools adopted tailored uniforms, mostly Japanese, they found Gyeongseong Yangbok Institute, while Korean tailors started their own organization called Hanseong Yangbok Tailors. Although there were many tailors, suits in woolen textile were still expensive. As is shown in the advertisement of used clothes from the US, pure wool fabric was greatly coveted and thus was in high demand. Where is the used book? This is just advertisement that the woolen tailored clothes are warm. That's what they are saying. And then this is a famous Jongno tailors. They were actually established in the 1920s and they are still in business. There is actually a book called Jongno Tailors of 100 Years. It's like a fourth generation business now. Just like a fashion magazine, you sometimes have to really promote new style to draw people's attention. So there are like a new season comes, then especially when the autumn comes, they are going to advertise their woolen tailors. You don't advertise suit in the summer. Who's going to wear that, you know, like a hot woolen textile? So this is what I wanted to talk about, the used clothes. Do you see here? Do you see American flag? So it's authentic symbol of this is made in USA. So here these are type of clothes. It's made in the US, but these are used clothes. So it's affordable. So it's about 1935. Then I'm going to talk about that images on the right. Unlike cotton textiles, produced in factories, woolen textiles was very limited. Woolen textiles were very limited in Korea. During the Second Sino-Japanese War in the 1930s, Japanese colonial government ordered people in the northern provinces of Korea to raise 5 Australian sheep per household, while people in the south to cultivate cotton. So there was a colonial government's policy of northern province producing raw wool and then southern provinces producing cottons. Why? Not just to sell, in order to create enough for military supplies. It's very important because the Second Sino-Japanese War is taking place in Manchu. It's cold. So in order to prepare for a prolonged war, you need to, you know, give enough supply to military. So this is actually a rare photograph of showing the wools imported from Australia, and then they are going to be distributed to some families in northern provinces of Korean Peninsula, currently like North Korea. Suitable weather for sheep growing. Unlike cotton textiles produced in factories in Korea, woolen textiles were only produced in Japanese factories. So again, they raised raw wool, but they didn't teach the technique of weaving woolen textiles in Korea. All the raw wool went to Japan, within the Korean Peninsula, people learned how to do cotton weaving. So with the policy of providing raw wool materials to Japan, Korea became a colony colonial market for expensive woolen fabric produced by Japanese industrial companies. It was only after 1945 that the Korean industrialist launched a wool textile weaving factory. So do you recognize any of this company? Probably not, but Joseon Bangjik and then Gyeongseong Bangjik, there are two large cotton manufacturing facilities in Korea. Joseon Bangjik was made by Japanese capital, and then Gyeongseong Bangjik was by Korean nationalist capital. So you can see the difference in the advertisement is very important. She has another version of a Korean national flag, and then this is the our own cotton fabric. So that's why she has in this Korean traditional clothes. So sort of a national spirit. So in his book, Assimilating Seoul, Todd Henry studies Seoul as a modernized colonial city and offers a transnational account that treats the city's public space as contact zones, showing how Korean residents negotiated the pressure to become loyal, industrious, and hygienic subjects of the Japanese Empire. Although the colonial state set ambitious goals for the integration of Koreans, elite Japanese settlers and lower class expatriates shaped the speed and direction of assimilation by bending government initiatives to their own interests and identities. An engineer for the government general of Korea, an engineer of the government general of Korea, Lee Sang, carried a meticulous image of a modern urban elite. Tailored suits in imported woolen fabric were worn mainly by teachers, bank officials, clerical workers of all kinds, in short, by growing but still very small modern professional middle class, either in Japan, Korea, or China. Department stores were important parts of urban life, as is discussed in Park Tae-won's novel A Day in the Life of Novelist Gubo, written in 1934. The protagonist, Gubo, who cannot make a good living out of his writing career, could barely afford a ready-made skirt for his mother. Where can you buy a ready-made skirt? At the department store. But he's a novelist, so he didn't have any money. So he really grumbles over his misery, that, you know, where can I get the money? And mother is unhappy. Neither could he buy a blouse for his love interest. So actually he was, again, sort of dumped by his love interest because he cannot provide. Nonetheless, he was a proud dandy of urban modernity who frequented a cafe, a department store, and a park with his notebook and walking cane. If you read this novel, like A Day in the Novelist of Gubo, he really cares about his walking cane. Because when he goes to the cafe, he drops off certain places. When he leaves, he makes sure that he carries the walking cane. It's like a very proud, like a symbol of his own existence, like in order to walk the streets of Gyeongsang or Seoul. But his pocket is empty, he has a walking cane. Due to a limited supply and exorbitant price, woolen fabric remained beyond the means of, beyond the means of ordinary, beyond the means of ordinary people. The colonial government of Japan encouraged an image of modern male citizens well-dressed in tailored suits and expensive woolen textiles in propagandistic newspapers and magazines. Nonetheless, ordinary citizens without prominent appointment in the colonial regime chose to be selectively modern. As one sees in this crowd headshot, do you see that this is a head shop? Or you cannot see very well. I'm going to analyze the picture first. If you read the Chinese character, it actually says, we specialize the hats. That's what it says. And then the caption, like it's they are like a name of the store. So it's the Zhongro, the streets of Zhongro, and there is a big store, you know, two-story. But if you see the show window on the first floor, can you see a little bit that there are hats? Hang on the windows? like here. So there is a display window to show hats. So where to go into the hat store? Who goes into the hat store? Men, right? So that's why there are a lot of men. But in a way, because a lot of men got together here, it's sort of a, it's not really a cafe, but it's a way, in a place where people get together. So people get together, and what do? Talk about politics, and talk about economies, right? So here, there are a lot of people got together, and also this shop happens to have that terrace on the second floor, on the street of Jongno. So these people are actually looking at the funeral procession of Emperor Gojong. Emperor Gojong passed away after the annexation of Korea. It's a really sad day, so they are, lining up to have a farewell to the wake of Emperor Gojong. But do you see these men? All like a prominently wear hats. These are a very typical view. They may have the durumagi or the wrong robe, but then at least they have one item of modern fashion. So hat or like a cane or shoes. There are equivalent shops of shoes on this street. These are like a hybrid image, fashion of the colonial Korea. As we see in this crowd in a hat shop in Jongno shopping district in Seoul in 1919, the most important luxury item was a top hat. Whether dressed in tailored suit or durumagi with a hanbok underneath, men adopted a modern accessory made of wool, in this case a hat. Sometimes they carried a cane stick and put on leather shoes. Sometimes they wore eyeglasses and pocket watches. This hybrid dandyism was an embodiment of modern fashion as a changing trend of clothing and accessories adopted by middle or working class citizens of any colonial city in East Asia. And wrist watches are very expensive too. At some point, according to study by Japanese scholar, it's like an average 6 months salary of a low income factory worker. You have to save 6 months in order to buy wristwatch. So people used to buy watches for wedding gifts. It's like a big expenditure. In colonial Korea, there were factories to create the cotton textiles because there is a lot of demand for cotton textiles, right, especially for ordinary citizens. But I don't know whether you've heard of this name called Gyeongnam. Gyeongnam Mojik, it means Gyeongnam woolen textile, or this is their factory. Previously, there was Korea Mojik, and then Jail Mojik. These are actually the woolen textile factories, but they only started after 1945. Japanese government didn't encourage it because Korea is a colonial market. You have to sell manufactured products. You dump them on the colonial citizens. But Jail Mojik that you see on the second line, these are actually the parent company of Samsung, of our, the global company Samsung, where you can buy cell phones and televisions. Their original start is actually the Jail Mojik. That created a big profit for the company. Even in the 1970s, when people get married as a wedding gifts, people give Jail Mojik's tailoring textiles as a gift. You will get a box of it, and then you bring it to tailor and made it for yourself. I want to talk a little bit more about, this is actually a view of the department stores in Seoul, and you can actually read a lot about it, but some of the department stores in colonial period are still department stores now. Talk a little bit about cultural cross-dressing. In Asia, from 1900 to 1930s, people adopted a piece of European clothing, even though they are wealthy or not. But what about consumption of Asian clothing by non-Asians? That's the definition of cultural cross-dressing. Cross-dressing, as you understand, this is men wear women's clothes, women wear men's clothes, right? There are cross-dressers, not in a very positive way, but cultural cross-dressing is, for example, non-Westerners wearing Western clothes versus, Westerners wearing like Asian or African, you know, other ethnic clothes. So it was very popular at the turn of the 19th century, all the way to the well into early 20th century. So, for example, who's going to wear Asian clothes? Anthropologists like this. And Frederick Starr was a very popular anthropologist. He was invited as a guest by the Japanese government. He was in Japan for 2 years, and then eventually he went to Korea. But this is invitation by the Japanese colonial government. In the Japanese newspaper, he was portrayed like this, wearing Japanese clothes. Again, the way he sat down is very, authentic Japanese way. So how do we interpret this type of cultural cross-dressing? In a very innocent and inviting way, this is a nice gesture of I love your culture. Do you agree? Hugely, right? It's a sort of surface value. But there are more undertones than the friendly gesture, because you have to see its own visual culture at the time. One of the really pioneer of adopting the Asian clothes is actually name is Charlie Longfellow. You probably familiar with Longfellow's last name, and he's the son of famous poet Henry Longfellow. He liked Asian culture, so he went to Japan, and then he came back, and look at him. He had this samurai, clothes. And again, it's his gesture of saying, I really like Japanese culture, right? And then when he came home, he decorated his own family house with a Japanese fan motif on the ceiling. Great lover of Japanese culture, right? And not only that, if you read Christine Guth's book, he actually got a tattoo on his back. So he got the carp, the Japanese, like a auspicious fish on his back. So what do you think his mother said? Oh, my son is out of mind, Well, so he is a very fashionable person, carrying this. But then what do you think of this? Well, before we look at the photograph, let's focus on this famous painting. You've all seen this painting, right? Once or twice. And this is obviously Japanese kimono dress, beautifully embroidered. And then on the top, actually, it's the samurai, with a sword embroidered on a beautiful red gown. But who is this she? Monet's wife, Camille Monet, right? So at the time, especially 1870s, Japonism, Japanese culture, was very popular among Parisian elite and intellectuals. So Monet and as you know, Van Gogh later on, they are great lovers of Japanese culture. So again, she's saying, I really like your culture. Well, you see, something's a bit strange. Well, in this case, she, do you see her blonde hair? Mm-hmm. This is actually a wig. She's not blonde. No. She's a little bit darker hair, but she intentionally put the wig because Monet wanted to accentuate the disparity between the Asian clothes and the European wearer. So it's obviously very authentically a European blonde woman wearing fashionable Japanese clothes and then other fans. But is this really authentic love of Japanese culture? Or do you now see a little bit of appropriation?
Orientalism.
Yeah, Orientalism, right? Like they love it, but they love in their own way, and they love Asian culture because it's different from their own. Do you see the point? Really alienate Asian culture into a certain corner, and because it's very exotic and then it's very unusual, of course they admire those unusualness in craftsmanship and other things, but then they really accentuate the difference. And that's why they put this blonde wig, and especially very you know, like even imitating the Japanese, you know, dancers' posture in this manner. So what happened recently? The Museum of Fine Arts created this public program that, you know, you are going to come and this, you know, portraiture of the 19th century, and then you can dress yourself in Japanese kimono and take a picture of yourself. How popular public program that is, right? But then a group of Asian activists, like somebody who probably educated in this kind of institution, like Asian American Research Institute, they, you know, they pointed out that this is really, you know, a bad example of Orientalism. So here, the MFA is all about cultural experiences, try on the kimono, and racist, imperialist. So a group of activists felt that this is a sort of a mockery on certain tradition. So here, we see like the people participating in public programs, they found the exact replica of the kimono, and you know they want to have this photograph taken, but then there is a certain point. So this is not, this is an ongoing issue that I am still you know, discovering, and you know, away from this modern dress, I also study collectors of Asian art. And again, the 18th and 19th century collectors of Asian art are really heavily, you know, immersed in this idea of understanding Asia as the other, right? They like Asian art because it's very different from their own tradition. And this is a sort of a precedent of Monet's painting. It's made by McNeil Whistler, he's an American artist from the 19th century. And this is called The Princess of the Land of Porcelain. And again, Japanese clothes with a fan and Japanese screen painting on the background. But then she's very pale white and, you know, the European lady. And another collector who eventually purchased this painting, Charles Langfrier, exhibited along with the Chinese porcelain that he collected. So this is at the Freer Gallery in Washington, D.C. You probably have seen it. It's in the famous Peacock Room. So I am not really blaming or criticizing, you know, all this effort of collecting Asian art, but I want you to think about this undercurrent tone of Orientalism and how pervasive that is, even today. That's why, you know, you have this Camille, Monet's portraiture became a big issue. But again, if we think about the, you know, understanding of Asian culture, this man, a physician from Boston, Bigelow, and he also went to Japan in the 1870s, and he was really immersed in Japanese culture. So as you can see, he converted himself to Buddhism. So he became a Japanese Buddhism. So this is one of his photographs in like a Japanese style raincoat, right? And then the hat, and then the walking shoes, all of these. But this is what the popular would see in a newspaper in Boston. Sort of eccentric. That's why actually Bigelow is called one of those Boston eccentrics. There are more. But I want you to think about, you know, what the ramification of adopting other people's clothes. Not other people, like other cultures' clothes. Again, it's a very friendly gesture saying that I really like your culture. But what about this? There was actually an article written on this particular presentation of world leaders in Korean traditional dress in 2005. But it's not just Korea, like there are other occasions too. So do you see President Bush? On the back row here. But because they are all dressed in this you know, like ethnic clothes, you can actually see him very well, but he's on the back row right here. And then this is President of Korea at the time. And then you see the Koizumi. Do you see the Koizumi, you know, the third from the right? So what do you think of these? So this is a continuation of, you know, like a cultural cross-dressing, meaning that I love your culture, right? And probably they want you to again show that friendly gesture toward the hosting country, like we really respect your own culture and doing this. But again, like a cultural appropriation, it may be offensive to some type of people or in you know in the context. It's almost over, so we can have a yeah. So what about this? So say almost in group of people, and where did they go? Vietnam. Vietnam. So they are all dressed in this. But these are something you know that we know. I want to explore more about what it means, the cultural cross-dressing. Yes.
Comment.
Yeah.
What we are calling Orientalism today, isn't that just the flip side of the picture of the dandies, you know, the young Korean writers in Western dress? Mm. It's wearing other people, wearing the clothes of another culture. Mm. It's just, I mean, it happened more than a century ago. Mm-hmm. It really is the flip side of this and that.
Mm. Well, what you are saying is that Korean young you know, women wearing the
young men, young writers wearing
yes, suits. Yes, yeah. I mean, we don't call it like Orientalism, but their way of like exoticizing, you know, like a European culture, right?
Yes, yes.
I see what you are saying. But the difference is like this dress reform was a massive nationwide policy, so that you know, even today, you know, because of this legacy of modernism, in Asian countries, the business suitable business attire is European suit. Mm-hmm. So as you see, in 1930s, there was again hybrid fashion, and some people adopted, but some majority of people did not. But eventually, after the Second World War, it's implemented as a proper business attire. So now, you know, in a banking or any other official attire, occasion you show up in the turumagi or you know, like that, you know, traditional clothes, then people think, is he going to any like a family gathering or special occasion, right? It changed. So that's why there is a bigger legacy of modernism, like a Eurocentric modernism imposed on the entire Asian countries. But anyway, it was a very good point. Yes.
Also, I don't know what the background of this is. Who is it that decided to do this? And, you know, in my experience in China, the government likes to do this,
right?
To make uniform things for
exactly.
Because Americans don't tend to be uniform people. So when I see a uniform, I think that was it. That was somebody from Korea, wherever they are, but Vietnam's idea.
But it's interesting, like a uniform, like wearing the same clothes, right? There is a certain, like a conformity, you know, to a certain, you know, degree of uniformity. But on the other hand, because of this sort of, you know, Asian countries or, you know, people in, or artists or people in Asia, they really want to live up to the expectation of viewers or the European audiences because there is a certain long, you know, degree of tradition. I think even still today, they want to really live up to that goal, like disseminating our own culture to the broad. So this is, in a way, their cultural pride that, you know, it's our traditional clothes, but all, you know, all the people from, you know, Europe or North America, they adopted our clothes, so they think it's a very, you know, good point of pride.
Point.
Yeah.
It doesn't seem to me.
Right, right. Derogating, yeah. Right. I mean, it's not. Right. But as a scholar, you know, as an intellectual, I want, you know, the government officials or, you know, the leaders in these cultural institutions to think one more time about what is the historical legacy behind this, like this cultural exhibitionism in a way?
Yeah. Right.
They really want. You know, they want to take this photograph. That's it. You know, it's not. You know, that they. You know, they really want to advertise, promote that they came and they honored our culture, and that's why they all dressed up here. But I want you to. I mean, I want the policy leaders to think about one more time what the legacy is. And the reason I bring up this issue is the professional development of Asian artists, especially Asian American artists in Europe and, you know, North America, it's really, really hard. Asian artists, I just had a conversation with, you know, Russell before the, you know, lecture started. Purely Asian artists coming to other countries and show their works and make their career is somewhat easier. But think about the Asian American artist or like African American artist trying to build their career or their own voice is extremely hard because the condition is already predetermined by the majority of people who are very immersed in this long you know, legacies of Orientalism or any other cultural legacies. But it's a side, you know, topic. But yes.
Yeah, there's a huge difference between cultural appropriation, a genuine, respectful cultural exchange, and assimilation for survival. Like, for example, if, like, I as a Chinese American, like, my family's from, like, Guangzhou and Hong Kong, like, Canton and Hong Kong, so, like, I would love to go around, like, wearing Cheongsam or, like, K-pop, like, in my everyday life, but that would exoticize me further than, like, I already am. Like, people would make more assumptions about, like, my heritage, like, my ethnicity, my race, than they already do. They would make even more assumptions about, like, my capabilities than they already do. And, you know, I already have to deal with fetishization enough as it is by non-Asians, especially by white people, as it is. So why would I make myself, like, why would I heighten myself as, like, why would I make myself a greater target of this kind of racism, exotification, and Orientalism? Like, and yeah, as for the whole, like, the cultural appropriation and assimilation, like, equating to, that's a false equivalence. Like, assimilation for survival, like, people love to say this, like, when they want to defend cultural appropriation, they love saying, oh, why can't I, as a white person, like, wear, like, a kimono? Isn't that the same thing as, like, Asian people or black people or, like, any non-white person living in the West wearing jeans? It's not. It's not the same thing.
I really like the way you organize, you know, the idea. That's actually where I was getting it, but you theorize even better, right? Assimilation for survival is a really big issue. And, you know, based on, like, your comment, what's interesting is I want you to think a little bit about the Native American culture. I recently went to Native Fashion Now. That was Native American designers using the motifs of Native American art, you know, like a, you know, like a very contemporary way, like a, you know, modern dresses. But at that symposium, some of the Native American artists actually said that they feel very offensive that non-Native American artists use their motifs and, you know, their, like, patterns, and then, you know, use it. And, you know, I mean, it's interesting to hear that they actually voiced concerns over their own heritage taken away and, you know, used in other contexts. Yeah, I mean, that's why, you know, here in the U.S., I mean, I lived about 20 years, but it's very hard for Asian Americans, like, really, they are American citizens, but, you know, try to come up with their own place or their own voice. And the way you talked about, like, you know, wearing your, like, cultural heritage clothes is somewhat, you know, you intentionally avoid it. But the same way, I have a friend from Hong Kong, and they are costume historians, and they love Cheongsam or, you know, this dress. I mean, they're actually very pretty, but they are very aware of this legacy of, you know, the change, the design of Cheongsam. That was drastically changed in 1930s. So they intentionally avoid those dress. But in Hong Kong, because this cultural pride of Chinese people in recent years, there is actually new associations of wearing Cheongsam in everyday occasion. So there are interesting, you know, like, and then I want to go to him, yeah, and then come back.
I think, I mean, while I'm sensitive to that traditional sort of critique, I'm comfortable with the idea that, you know, white people are barred from wearing certain clothing. You know, depending on the circumstances, it would be acceptable. I mean, I think for me, the point of analysis is about when did Western dress become the default and everyone can wear it because the business suit is the default sort of business attire. I think that issue is problematic itself. In the fact that we go back to that moment in time where Western attire becomes a default dress. And I think we have to focus on that issue because I would love to wear, like, what we think of now as the Mao suit was developed by Sun Yat-sen. And he wanted to develop a modern suit, but not like the Western suit. Right now it's become associated with Mao and
Communist.
North Korea. So it has taken on a different political meaning. But in its beginning, it had a different political meaning about modern, but Asian or Chinese at that point. So, although, like, with Boston, I understood the critique and I was there, but I was like, I don't, so when do white people get to wear that? Like, you know, like, if I look at Indian American women in New York or in America, I often see them wearing saris. And yes, growing up, I thought, oh, they're always wearing saris. But at a certain point in my head, I'm used to it. And then I feel like, oh, you have a different attachment to your traditional culture and your dress. You're much more comfortable. And then for me, you normalize it within this context. And I think you've advanced that conversation. Mm. You know, and so I think between Asian countries, it's quite different. I think Chinese people have a very tortured history with their clothing because they have the greatest political and cultural fracture in this century. And so I went to China recently and I went to a traditional Hanfu, traditional Chinese dress store, and I bought one and I wore it back. And my brother, who lives in China, we grew up here, but he lives in China, he said, "What are you doing with that costume?"
Costume.
This is not a costume.
It's not a Halloween.
This is not Halloween. That's if you grew up in the West and you think, this is traditional, that's a costume, right? I said, this is our culture. Why do I have to think of this as a costume, right? And so, I mean, I'm grappling with the difficulties of what is default and what we and how we have to come back from fracture away from our traditional dress to have some equality of like what everyone can wear. Some of those people were they loved that culture. That's where they wore it. If they wore it as costume, that's you can criticize it. But if they wear it as like I'm one of that, then that sounds okay to me.
I mean, in addition to this comment, there are actually a group of non-Asians wearing Asian clothes as if it's their second nature, right? There are really those people as well. And, you know, I am not, you know, criticizing or taking sides, but I, you know, just want you to think about these type of cultural idioms, what presents to you. And then regarding that European tailored suit becoming the, you know, default business attire, you know, if you think about this Saudi Arabians, or have you ever been to the Museum of Modern Art new exhibition called Is Fashion Modern? Like items. If you go to that exhibition, actually, it answers a lot of those. In West Asia, like women, predominantly, like including South Asia, they still wear their traditional dress every day and occasions and, you know, anywhere, anytime. And also men, especially the West Asia, they still wear their clothes. But if you think about the Yasser Arafat, remember the Palestinian the liberation? He always wear suit and wear the Palestinian headband. And I think his way, you know, gesture of trying to communicate with
clothing is political.
People.
I mean, you go
exactly.
Back to the French Revolution and
the sans-culottes. Yeah, right? Sans-culottes.
So as a political expression, clothing is, since the beginning of the Western political revolution, been a way to express your political identity and where you belong in that.
And then, you know, regarding the political, you know, aspects, you know, in South Korea currently, and then also 1990s, if you wear the traditional clothes, like a modernized version of traditional clothes all the time, then you are considered as a political activist. It's like, you know, you take a side with the nationalist or, you know, nationalist spirit. So again, you know, clothing are, you know, loaded with meanings, and it's one of my you know, research interests because I teach at FIT. I was never quite interested in clothing per se. I mean, as you can see, I'm not like a fashion people, but students are always interested in these fashion items, and that's how I, you know, try to, you know, expand my research interest by going into those areas. And it's a very interesting field. There is economic history, definitely, and then there is like a history of science involved, like, and then there is this representations, like a visual representation and symbolic representations all together. So that's how I collaborated this book project with Professor Ida Wien Wong at Brandeis University. She and I are both art historians. We were not trained in costume history or textile history, but it's in a way like a visual elements that invite further interpretations. So that's why we gathered a group of scholars. Any questions? Any other comments? Yes, all the way in the back.
I might mention that some of you might know Danny Yeung, who's a very important artist now. He represents Hong Kong as the official artist from Hong Kong, as the country of Hong Kong, the city of Hong Kong. And Danny, when he was working here in New York in the 70s, had formed Basement Workshop, he designed a long Chinese
handful
made out of cotton. That was quilted, and he wore it to various some events. More recently, you have an artist like Dorothy Imagre, who is half Iranian and half Japanese, who became an artist in order to make art about the camps that she discovered when she was an adult going to college, that her mother was in the camps during World War II. She eventually came to design kimonos for people like herself who are mixed race. And so she came upon an African-American who was half Japanese. And she designed for him after, you know, interviewing people like this, a kimono on the outside, which it looks Japanese, but on the inside, the fabric was African fabrics.
Ah, I see. Interesting.
So this is a very crucial issue for us, and the kind of development, you know, when there was the effort to create one universal language, right, for global commerce. But we may, if our Trump is indicating how we are going in the future, like I just talked to an artist from Afghanistan and Australia, and he's saying that everybody there understands Trump as wanting to be king. He does not want to keep democracy. And so if that kind of tendency in the country is going to continue, then we may all be dressed like in the United Nations in our own ethnic clothing. So we don't try to mix politically for survival. We may adopt our clothing to be indicating exactly our ethnicity.
It's like pronouns. You know, these days we have a movement that pronouns it's by your choice, right? If you want to be called she, you always be called she, like, you know, people market. And, you know, the clothing, you know, can be also those kind of, you know, neutral component, but very far away. And, you know, it's very layered code of symbols. Any other comment? Ah, yes.
Just kind of personal experience. There was this one time that I was prom dress shopping a few years ago, and I came across, I'm Korean, so I came across this strange website. They sold prom dresses of like hanbok, so our traditional wear, but it was cut in so that it wouldn't be like an overcoat with the under. It would just be one dress, but still kind of split into two sections, so it would just cut off here, so it had no shoulder or whatever. And then this photo just reminded me of it because you couldn't clearly see that it's just like an overcoat.
Oh, yes, underneath they have their suit, right?
So,
yeah, this is another hybrid fashion in a way,
yeah,
yes.
So I actually thought this one was just so funny. Just because I like knowing how many layers and works go into hanbok, and then seeing this and the picture after it, but they're just putting it on
the top, just for a photo shoot, actually.
Yeah.
They didn't wear for the whole day, like for a few minutes, right?
No matter what the intention is, it kind of takes away from the personalization of clothing.
Personalization, yes.
Because
very good comment.
Like, my mom's hanbok was passed down to my grandma, and I fit it to them, and it had the colors they liked, no matter if it was symbolic or not. And so I think the future of fashion in terms of non-Western fashion is going to be a strange hybridization, but I think there's power in being able to reclaim our original fashion and things where it came from.
Yeah, that was a very good comment. And also sometimes, you know, like ethnic dress, it's really exoticized. So there's something, it's really away from the traditional symbolism. And as you all know, you know, a lot of ethnic clothes have a color symbolism and the shape symbolism. And, you know, there are unmarried women should wear certain colors versus married women should wear, you know, certain colors. And, you know, married women with a few sons and, you know, husband in a high office can have certain clothes and you shouldn't wear those, right? But then, you know, these are all violated. And also in contemporary designers' practices, they really appropriate, you know, these components for their aesthetic, you know, accomplishment and, you know, like what is the boundaries, and it's something that we should think more. Like in visual arts, appropriation or cultural appropriation is a big issue, right? Like there are people are so vigilant, but when it comes to clothing, it's less. Like it's clothing, it's more like how you are you know, like ordinary conversation. And but there are more meanings, and you know, you can have certain activisms or you know, more engagement of your own conscience involved. Any other comment or talk? Yes.
Well, I really appreciate your comment because, like cultural appropriation and cultural exchange, it is highly contextual. It is highly situational. Like there are times when it would be okay for like a non-Chinese person to wear like
tulsam, right?
Or like, let's say if I were going to like an Indian friend's wedding and they invited wedding guests to wear a sari, then yeah, I can wear a sari. But am I gonna go out and buy a sari and wear it in my everyday life? No, I wouldn't feel right doing that. Like that's just an example. Like there are times when you can do it. If someone from that culture invites you to do it at like a certain occasion, or if you're in that country and want to show respect for like the cultural norms there, okay, fine. But if you're just somebody who wants to like cherry pick like the pretty parts, the attractive parts of someone's culture because you think it's cool, then I'm not okay with that.
But on the other hand, if you spend 20 years of your life in India and you know you really involved in like Indian you know, other cause, then I think it's okay to wear Indian sari every single day.
I mean, here in the U.S., I wouldn't.
Oh, you wouldn't? Like, even you wouldn't?
If I were to live abroad in India and like most of the women there wear that on day to day, then sure, I guess I would consider it.
I don't know. I mean, if I were that kind of case, you know, I spent like 30 years in India and came back here, and I would still wear sari, you know, because like I'm really acculturated to Indian culture. I mean, I don't know. It's another question? Yes, Russell?
So sometimes besides the ethnic question, sometimes like for myself as an Asian male, a lot of, I basically never wear a white shirt and black pants.
yeah, that's also true,
or,
right?
You know, more water, or you know, I dropped my chopstick or fork. I mean, I used to run a restaurant, so sometimes you know. But then one time I went to some professional conference, I think a sociologist conference. I didn't want to buy the ticket, so I just wore a white shirt and black pants and carried the tray. I got them for free because, you know, they would just assume an Asian with a white shirt and black pants, you know, is certainly doing a certain function. So sometimes, you know, it's not just.
That's an interesting point. I mean, there is a term called dressed for survival, right? If you, do you know what I mean? Dressed for survival, like, you know, as we've seen in Black Lives Matter, you know, why this, you know, little, you know, boy, like a Tyrone, like in Florida, killed because he had a hoodie on, right? Like, he looked so big. And then, yeah, there is a certain, you know, cultural conventions and, you know, social, you know, like biases. Tied together. But what I want to tell you is there is really like a bad, you know, it's not really bad, but improper, you know, use of symbols. When I went to the Native American Fashion Now, you know, symposium, there was our colleague, Professor Daniel Cole from MFIT, and he was talking about the Mohawk headgear. Do you know what Mohawk headgear is? So it has its own context, right? It's usually used for ritual, like a dance or, you know, something, and it, you know, that's Native American context. But in the Philippines, and then according to Professor Cole, in Singapore, they wear the Mohawk, you know, the headgear for parties. Whenever there is a party, they somehow think that it should be a wild, you know, fun party. Then they put the Mohawk head, you know, like a feathers, and, you know, they go out to party. And sometimes Halloween party parade, a lot of men, they wear also the Mohawk headgear. And it may be very offensive to Native American, you know, people. It's sort of a, you know, it's really misappropriated. And then people wearing those have no clue what's the use of it. They just wear it. It's a cool thing. It's a Mohawk headgear. And then the dream catcher too. You know, the dream catcher is sold actually in South Asia, Indonesia, everywhere. But it's like a Native American, like a symbol of, you know, catching the dream and, you know, good luck. And then Mohawk gear as well as the dream catcher, they are all made in China. Like, it's a totally, you know, if you really, you know, value the Native American craftsmanship, you know, you commission it, you know, create those, and, but it's not. I mean, it's all made in China, and probably a lot of designers and workers are really detached from the original symbols or context. So that was, you know, another like examples of showing. And I always wonder what people would think of me wearing in Scandinavian dresses. That's really cute. But I think they probably think I am a Korean adoptee to Scandinavian country. Right, it's acceptable, right? I can wear it, but then they will think maybe she's called like a Hannah Anderson, right? Adopted by Scandinavian, you know, parents. Is there any other question? It's almost 8, so it was a very engaging audience. I'm very pleased, and your questions are very insightful for me, so I will think more. Maybe we should conclude our lecture today and then enjoy some more refreshments. One more question.
Just one question. Mm-hmm. Is your course open to auditors who are not registered at FIT?
I actually teach Asian American art and design. And at FIT. And I only teach Asian American art and design in the first semester. You can register as a senior learner if you want to. I mean, I'm not saying that you are senior, but we have a program for community members, and that's called the Senior Learner Program. So you can come and take the class. So I teach Asian American and Korean art in the fall, and then Japanese art and the Silk Road in the spring semester. And I always welcome like a costume enthusiast in my Silk Road class. We are going to study the Central Asian textiles and other types of artworks as well, Buddhist statues and other things. Any other questions? You can find me at the school website, you know, with my name. Then you can email me, and we stay in touch. And thank you so much for coming. It was a long night.